Preschool is a period of growth and development. Children are beginning to expand their communicative interactions beyond their family members. They are forced out of their linguistic comfort zone and must learn how to form new bonds with their peers. Children's early social experience contributes to the development of their capacity to build relationships with family or peers, and it is also an important foundation for learning. Bilingual children have the added stress of monitoring which language is being used and how to appropriately respond in that language. According to the National Center for Education Statistics, approximately 21% of children ages 5 to 17 speak a language other than English in the home. Bilingual children can be separated into three terms. You can see in the chart that the three terms are defined. The children that we worked with were English language learners, which are language minority students in the U.S. who are learning English, the majority language, for social interaction and educational purposes. Stuttering onset often occurs around the preschool age, from about 20 to 48 months of age. Children around this age often display developmental disfluencies, such as part word repetitions, single syllable repetitions, multisyllabic word repetitions, phrase repetitions, interjections, revisions of incomplete phrases, prolongations, and tense pauses. There are no secondary behaviors, such as eye blinks, head nods, or interjections of extra sounds associated with normal disfluency. Children who are beginning to develop true non-developmental disfluencies develop tension during speech attempts, phonatory arrest, and with significant and notable frustration during speaking. Natural recovery is extremely common for children who stutter. Research concerning stuttering in bilingual preschoolers is sparse. It is estimated that 75% of children who stutter will stop spontaneously. Much of the available research on stuttering is diverted from monolingual speakers. Therefore, the outcomes of these studies can only be applied to monolingual children. Research on identification and intervention with bilingual preschool children is lacking. Additionally, there is evidence that the mode of assessment does not influence the measure of stuttering severity. This information, however, was obtained from adult studies and therefore cannot be applied to children. So our research questions were, do bilingual preschool children demonstrate normal developmental disfluencies? What is the frequency of occurrence of normal developmental speech disfluencies in bilingual preschool children? What is the frequency of occurrence of non-developmental speech disfluencies in bilingual preschool children? And does a difference exist between the frequency of occurrence of normal developmental speech disfluencies from live data versus audio recorded data? The study was designed as a cross-sectional perspective non-randomized investigation. Institutional review board approval was sought and obtained from Bridgewater State University. The purpose of the study was to examine spontaneous speech fluency of normal bilingual preschoolers obtained during an oral narrative task involving a conversation interview, to determine what type of disfluencies may be present, and to investigate if there is a difference between fluency data obtained live and data obtained during an audio transcription. We had 10 children ages 3 to 5 who were enrolled in the study, and they can be seen in the chart. Our original plan was to recruit 20 to 30 preschoolers from area Head Start programs. However, we were not made aware that many of these children returned to their home country during the summer months. Therefore, we recruited 10. All of the participants were recruited from two locations, Cape Cod Child Development in Hyannis, Mass., and Self-Help Head Start, Inc. Head Start in Brockton, Mass. Consent forms were translated into the home language were distributed to the caregivers by the faculty when the participant was brought to the facility for their normally scheduled school day. Two examiners were used for data collection, the author, and an ASHA-certified and Massachusetts State-licensed speech-language pathologist trained in research technique. During all testing sessions, uniformity across conditions and examiners was maintained. Only the author and second examiner had access to participants' identifying information. Participants' identifying information was coded for confidentiality purposes. The stuttering severity instrument, which is a normed reference stuttering assessment that can be used for both clinical and research purposes, was used. Teacher questionnaires were also used and completed by the participants' teachers. These were used to document the participants' use and proficiency in English. This was done to document the child's level of receptive and expressive English without formal testing. And these were what they looked like. Our inclusionary criteria included children who spoke Spanish or Brazilian Portuguese in the home, children who were competent in English, both in use and proficiency, and children who were 3 to 5 years of age. Children who were receiving speech or language intervention services those with cognitive disabilities or genetic disorders were excluded from the study. A corpus of 100 words was obtained by examiners. It was audio taped and then transcribed. Live data was also obtained during the time of speech sampling. It was recorded by investigators by using a system of dots and slashes. Dots represented spoken words and slashes represented a stuttered event. Fluency can be thought of as the effortless flow of speech. A person who is fluent uses little effort to speak. Disfluency can be used to describe stuttering and normal disfluency as it can refer to hesitations made while speaking. Each participant's speech sample was coded by the author and second examiner as either fluent or disfluent. For independent variables, we had stuttered events for live data and stuttered events for audio recorded data. Because the fluency data was coded subjectively, inter-rater reliability was used. Two speech samples from five participants were chosen. Coded data from selected participants was collected by each examiner were analyzed using non-parametric related samples Wilcoxon ranks test. No significant differences between examiners were found. The purpose of this study were to determine if bilingual children demonstrate normal developmental speech disfluencies, the frequency of occurrence for normal developmental speech disfluencies in bilingual children, and additionally, an effort was made to determine if a difference existed between the frequency of occurrence of normal developmental speech disfluencies from live data versus audio recorded data. Descriptive statistics scores were diverted for the total sample of frequency of stuttered events. All statistical analysis were performed with a type 1 error rate for all source of variance set as p equals 0.05. In order to compare speech fluency samples on a base of live versus audio data, a related samples Wilcoxon ranks test was performed. Two children, subject 9 and subject 10, were excluded from the study. Subject 9 was suspected to demonstrate selective mutism, though this was an unconfirmed diagnosis, and subject 10 was new to the program and acclimating to her environment, and she retained her right of refusal and did not speak to the examiners. Subjects 1 through 8 participated in the study. Four of the participants were male and four were female. Two spoke Spanish and six spoke Brazilian Portuguese. Six of the children were 5 years of age and two were 4 years of age. It will be recalled that this investigation focused on the occurrence of developmental disfluencies and whether there was a significant difference between data obtained live and via audio recording. As you can see from the chart below, the frequency of occurrence for live data for both investigators never exceeds 3. And for audio recorded data, the frequency of occurrence never exceeds 5. As can be seen in the table below, the related samples Wilcoxon ranks test shows the mean of differences between live and audio recorded data obtained by examiner 1 was 0.017. Therefore, the findings show that there is a significant difference between the data recorded live and the data obtained via audio. The purpose of the study were to determine the frequency of occurrence of developmental and non-developmental disfluencies in a sample of 8 bilingual children and to investigate if there was a difference between fluency data obtained live and data obtained via audio. The significant difference between the live and the audio data support findings of Rousseau, Onslow, Packman, and Jones, who reported that their findings when using audio-only and audio-visual methods were significantly different. Their results also differed depending on the method in which the data was collected. This current study differed from the Rousseau study in several ways. The investigators were allowed to listen to the audio several times. This was because the participants maintained the articulatory, phonatory, and intonation patterns of their home language while speaking in English, and this made it very difficult for the investigators to understand what the child was saying, and therefore it was difficult to record their fluency. And in some cases, when the participant didn't know the word in English, they used the word in their home language. The participants in this study were normally developing children with no factors that would affect speech or language acquisition. The Rousseau study analyzed participants who were receiving treatment for stuttering. Now, though these studies differed in several ways, their results support the same hypothesis that perhaps one method of data collection is more efficient than the other. The results from this study suggest that audio recording is a more efficient method of data collection. All of the disfluencies recorded were considered normal disfluencies. The frequency of occurrence for non-developmental disfluencies was 0, and the frequency of occurrence for developmental disfluencies for both live and audio never exceeds 5. And these were some of the types of disfluencies that we found, and those are some actual quotes from the kids. The participants were acquiring and using two languages at the same time, yet demonstrated the same type of disfluencies as children in the process of acquiring one language. These children were English language learners and developed the same normal disfluencies as children their own age who are monolingual. The implications for early identification are substantial for a successful intervention of preschooler speech fluency disorders. Early intervention in speech-language pathology has shown that the earlier the disfluency is treated, the chance of developing normal communication skills increases. If disfluency is undiagnosed in early childhood, the child may stutter into adulthood. Bilingual children deserve an equal opportunity at early intervention, but in order for clinicians to choose appropriate intervention, an evidence base is needed and accurate identification is warranted. However, more evidence in this topic area is needed in order to more fully understand the nature of bilingual preschool children's speech development to ensure that they are provided fluency intervention services that they need.